Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to All Saints on this glorious All Saints Sunday. We are so glad you are here. If you're visiting with us today, you got a packet as you came in. The outer part is the announcements. You can set that aside. Inside is the service leaflet. It contains all the words of the service music, and the scripture readings. We will need hymnals for the hymns, and today we are using the 1982 hymnal, which you have in your hands. When it comes time for communion, everyone is welcome to receive the sacrament here. Instructions on how to receive the sacrament are included in the leaflet when we get to that part of the service. And we are not sending the children to Sunday school. They are here with us. All the saints are gathered. So let's just take a deep breath and a moment of silence before we continue our worship. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God, Amen.
There is one body and one spirit.
There is one hope in us all.
One Lord, one faith, one baptism.
One God, Father of all.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you have knit together your elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of your Son, Christ our Lord. Give us grace so to follow your blessed saints in all virtuous and godly living, that we may come to those ineffable joys that you have prepared for those who truly love you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God in glory everlasting.
Amen.
Please be seated for the readings.
A reading from the prophet Daniel. In the first year of the king Belshazzar of Babylon, Daniel had a dream and visions of his head as he lay in bed. Then he wrote down the dream. I, Daniel, saw in my vision by night the four winds of heaven stirring up the great sea, and four great beasts came up out of the sea, different from one another. As for me, Daniel, my spirit was troubled within me, and the visions of my head terrified me. I approached one of the attendants to ask him the truth concerning all of this. So he said that he would disclose to me the interpretation of this matter. As for these four great beasts, four kings shall arise out of the earth, but the holy ones of the Most High shall receive the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever, forever and ever. The word of the Lord.
A reading from Ephesians.
In Christ we have also obtained an inheritance, having been destined according to the purpose of Him who accomplishes all things according to His counsel and will, so that we, who were the first to set our hope on Christ, might live for the praise of His glory. In Him you also, when you had heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and had believed in Him, were marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. This is the pledge of our inheritance toward redemption as God's own people, to the praise of His glory. I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, and for this reason, I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know Him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which He has called you, what are the riches of His glorious inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of His power for us who believe, according to the working of His great power. God put this power to work in Christ when He raised Him from the dead and seated Him at the right hand of the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. And He has put all things under His feet and has made Him the head over all things for the church, which is His body, the fullness of Him who fills all in all. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Then Jesus looked up at his disciples and said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, and when they exclude you, revile you, and defame you on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for surely your reward is great in heaven. For that is what their ancestors did to the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you will be hungry. Woe to you who are laughing now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when all speak well of you, for that is what their ancestors did to the false prophets. But I say to you that listen, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who abuse you. If anyone strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also. And from anyone who takes away your coat, do not withhold even your shirt. Give to everyone who begs from you. And if anyone takes away your goods, do not ask for them again. Do to others as you would have them do to you." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Gracious God, grant us always to seek the truth, come whence it may, cost what it will. Amen. It's All Saints Sunday, and I'm excited, aren't you? This is our church's special day. It's our parish's feast day, and we have got it all going on here today, my. Worship at 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 5 o'clock. Yes, we had wiggle worship at 9 a.m. for families with tiny children. We have the mighty sound of brass instruments, thank you, and a fabulous anthem coming up. We have a personal story of stewardship to move us at every service. We are about to welcome a whole bunch of new members to All Saints, and we are going to baptize two beautiful babies, Grace and Victor, who begin their lives as saints of God this morning. And at the close of this service, we are going to sing a perfect hymn for this All Saints Sunday. It's a hymn that sparks one of two reactions, either a great big grin or an enormous eye roll. It's a lovely British hymn called "I Sing a Song of the Saints of God." When I said that, did you grin? Who rolled their eyes? Yeah, they're eye rollers. For those of you who aren't familiar with this hymn, you can decide at the end of the service if you're a big grinner or an eye roller. Now, you should know that I love this hymn. Each fall, I look forward to All Saints Sunday when we will sing this hymn again in all its sweet English beauty. I love the drama of the line that goes, "And one was slain by a fierce wild beast." And I love the Britishness in the last verse where you get to meet them in school or in lanes or at sea, in church or in trains or in shops or at tea. But most of all, I love the closing refrain. "For the saints of God are just folk like me, and I mean to be one too." The saints of God are just folk like me. Just folk like you, just folk like us. We forget that sometimes, I think. We read about great people like Oscar Romero or Francis of Assisi or Mother Teresa or Martin Luther King Jr. and we think how special they were, how unique, how noble, how courageous, how blessed they were. And most of the time, I believe that we think that the saints of God are just folk like those, the kind of people that live out the Beatitudes that Jesus speaks in today's gospel lesson. Saints are people who willingly become poor and hungry for God's sake, like St. Francis did. Saints work and long for righteousness to prevail, like Oscar Romero and Martin Luther King did. Saints weep over the brokenness of the world, like Mother Teresa did. Saints work for peace. Saints are willing to be reviled and persecuted for following Jesus. And yes, they are blessed. Oh, how very blessed. But to say that they were folk like me, folk like you, folk like us, how can we be saints? We are ordinary people living in a Midwestern college town, a land of farms and forests, soccer fields and sports bars. We spend our busy, busy days trying to make a living, trying to raise our children, trying to get together with our friends, trying to have a life. We try to be good, I believe that. We do try to be good. We practice acts of kindness. We practice acts of charity. But saints? I don't know about saints. When I look at my own life, I see a person who is trying very hard, but I know that I'm no saint. On my best days, I'm a halfway decent Christian. On my worst days, well, I'm probably in the company of people Jesus calls woes down upon. I am rich in so many material things. I am full of all kinds of food, most of which is bad for me. I long to be thought well of, to be spoken well of, to be liked, to be followed, to be friended, to be retweeted and shared, so people will think I am a wise and witty person. Woe to me, woe indeed. And yet that lovely little song insists that the saints of God are just folk like me, and I mean to be one too. When I think of that line, just folk like me, the person who inspires me, the person who reminds me that every sort of ordinary person can be a saint, is Rosa Parks. And if you've been in my office here at church, you know I have a giant poster of Rosa Parks on the wall behind my desk. It's the famous, it's restaged, but it's famous because she's sitting on a bus looking out a window. And above her picture on this poster in big type, it says, "Destiny." And under her picture, it says, "The choices you make in life ultimately determine your destiny." Rosa Parks was just folk like me. She was just folk like you or anyone else you might pass by as you drive around town, push your cart around at Meijer. She was nobody special, at least in the way our society would measure out specialness. She was an African-American woman with a menial job who had to ride the bus back and forth to work each day. And although she ended up living and dying eventually and is buried in Detroit at that time, she lived in Montgomery, Alabama in the 1950s, which was a tough city at a tough time in this nation's history. Yet she changed everything by making a choice, by refusing one day to give up her bus seat to a white person. It determined her destiny. And I wonder, where did Rosa Parks get that strength? Where did she get the courage? When did she realize that it was no longer enough to go along to get along? How did she decide to stand up for herself by sitting down in a bus seat that was not intended for her? True, she had come under the influence of Dr. King, who at that time was pastor of the Dexter Avenue Baptist Church. She was already part of the growing civil rights movement, and she had been trained in direct action and principles of racial equality. But even before she met Dr. King, Rosa Parks had come under the influence of Jesus Christ. She was steeped in the teachings and prayers of the AME Church of her youth. She was a habitual reader of Scripture. She knew that the prophets cried out against the wrongs imposed by the powerful upon the poor. She read how Moses led his people out of slavery into freedom. She recited the 23rd Psalm by heart, knowing that God would spread a table for her even in the presence of her enemies. And she remembered that even in the face of cruelty and unkindness, Jesus would still expect her to turn the other cheek. The choices we make in life determine our destiny. Rosa Parks' choice to sit down on that bus and not move was an important choice. But she made that choice because she first made that other critical life-transforming choice to be a disciple of Jesus. And it made all the difference. It made her a saint of God, someone who can live and speak and act and move in the world like an icon of Jesus Christ. But we don't become saints just out of the blue. Rosa Parks did not become a saint right out of the blue. She grew into it over the course of many years. And likewise, these two babies we are going to baptize in a few minutes are not going to become heroic, brave, self-giving, strong, and long-suffering just because we dab some water on their heads. They are not graduating into instant sainthood. Instead, they are becoming enrolled in a kind of a school for saints, you might call it. They are joining Christ's body, the church, and they will be forever changed. They are becoming members of our particular community here at All Saints, a community that prays together, that searches the scriptures, that wrestles with uncomfortable ideas, and that reaches out to each other and to the wider world. Like Rosa Parks in the AME church of her childhood, they are entering a community that will shape them through study, through worship, through love and service to others. We call this place a church, but it's really a saint training academy. And if we are serious about the last line of the hymn, if we really intend to become saints too, then we must let ourselves be taught and trained and formed and fitted by the life of this community. Because there is a saint inside each one of us waiting to be discovered and to be drawn out into the light and put to work. If we are to become the saints we say we mean to be, then we must be transformed by the time we spend here, by the things we do here. We must listen to the prophets and memorize the Psalms. We must gather week by week at this table to share communion with God and with each other. We must give with glad and generous hearts. We must reach out to those who need our love, our service, and our glad tidings of God's incredible love. And then, will we become saints? It can happen. It happens every day. The gospel of Jesus Christ changes people. It changes lives. It changes the course of history. It makes saints out of plain old ordinary people, people like Rosa Parks, people like us. Thanks be to God. The saints of God are just folk like me. And I don't know about you, but I mean to be one too. Amen. And if the baptismal candidates and their families and godparents would come forward and gather at the font. And if any children want to see better and you want to come down front and sit on the floor here so you can see what's happening. Hey, Will, I love that hat. That is styling. Check it.
His elbows.
Oh, he has little patches on his elbows. Let's see. Come on. Come on down. Well, they're all in groups, so bring your groups. Bring the kids. No, they're fine. They're fine. All right. The congregation, we are in the leaflet at the bottom of the front page, or we are on page 301 of the Book of Common Prayer, whichever you prefer. And the candidates for holy baptism will now be presented. And you guys go first.
I present Victor Aaron Martin to receive the sacrament of baptism.
I present Grace Louise Allen to receive the sacrament of baptism.
And these questions are specifically to the parents and godparents. Will you be responsible for seeing that the child you present is brought up in the Christian faith and life?
I will, with God's help.
Will you, by your prayers and witness, help this child to grow into the full stature of Christ?
I will, with God's help.
Do you renounce Satan and all the spiritual forces of wickedness that rebel against God?
I renounce them.
Do you renounce the evil powers of this world, which corrupt and destroy the creatures of God?
I renounce them.
Do you renounce all sinful desires that draw you from the love of God?
I renounce them.
Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Savior?
I do.
Do you put your whole trust in his grace and love?
I do.
Do you promise to follow and obey him as your Lord?
I do.
And now you guys get to make a sacred vow. Will you who witness these vows do all in your power to support these persons in their life in Christ?
We will.
Then please stand as you are able and let us join with those who are committing themselves to Christ and renew our own baptismal covenant. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit
and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in the prayers?
I will, with God's help.
Will you persevere in resisting evil, and whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord?
I will, with God's help.
Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ?
I will, with God's help.
Will you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself?
I will, with God's help.
Will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being?
I will, with God's help.
Let us now pray for these persons who are to receive the sacrament of new birth.
Respond to each bidding by saying, Lord, hear our prayer. Deliver them, O Lord, from the way of sin and death. Lord, hear our prayer. Open their hearts to your grace and truth. Lord, hear our prayer. Fill them with your holy and life-giving spirit. Lord, hear our prayer. Keep them in the faith and communion of your holy church. Lord, hear our prayer. Teach them to love others in the power of the Spirit. Lord, hear our prayer. Send them into the world in witness to your love. Lord, hear our prayer. And bring them to the fullness of your peace and glory. Lord, hear our prayer.
Grant, O Lord, that all who are baptized into the death of Jesus Christ, your Son, may live in the power of his resurrection and look for him to come again in glory, who lives and reigns now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
The congregation may be seated. As we continue with the thanksgiving over the water. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
We thank you, Almighty God, for the gift of water. Over it, the Holy Spirit moved in the beginning of creation. Through it, you led the children of Israel out of their bondage in Egypt into the land of promise. In it, your Son Jesus received the baptism of John and was anointed by the Holy Spirit as the Messiah, the Christ, to lead us through his death and resurrection from the bondage of sin into everlasting life. We thank you, Father, for the water of baptism. In it, we are buried with Christ in his death. By it, we share in his resurrection. Through it, we are reborn by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, in joyful obedience to your Son, we bring into his fellowship those who come to him in faith, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Now sanctify this water, we pray you, by the power of your Holy Spirit, that those who here are cleansed from sin and born again may continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Savior. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Give me the babies. Can I have your hand? Your head on the table. Hey. Hi. You ready? Are you ready? Yes, you are. Okay. Name this child.
Victor Aaron Martin.
Victor Aaron, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Hi, Grace. How are you? You want me back? Name this child.
Grace Louise Allen.
Grace Louise, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Oh, amen.
Oh, I got you.
You made it.
Great. Great. Yes.
Thank you.
I'll take the towel back. Thank you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that by water and the Holy Spirit you have bestowed upon these, your servants, the forgiveness of sin and have raised them to the new life of grace. Sustain them, O Lord, in your Holy Spirit. Give them an inquiring and discerning heart, the courage to will and to persevere, a spirit to know and to love you, and the gift of joy and wonder in all your works. Amen.
Victor, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit and baptism,
my
and marked as Christ's own forever.
Amen.
And Grace, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit and baptism, and marked as Christ's own forever.
Amen. Amen.
Please stand as you are able and let us welcome the newly baptized. We receive you into the household of God. Confess the faith of Christ crucified, proclaim his resurrection, and share with us in his eternal priesthood. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Vestry person of the day?
Do we have a
vestry person of the day? Let's see. Otherwise, I can do it. Deidre. Is Deidre here? Oh, well, I'll do it. In your announcements section, there are some important announcements to call your attention to. The first important announcement is, if you are a visitor or a newcomer, there are visitor cards in the pew racks in front of you. If you would like to know more about All Saints, please take a moment and fill out the card. You can put that in the offering plate as it comes by, and know that that is the only offering we ask of our guests today, is for you to give us the opportunity to say thank you for being here. Also, immediately after the service, we have a wonderful coffee hour downstairs in the room directly beneath us. Take either sets of stairs or the elevator all the way down. Important announcements for today. Next week is Celebration Sunday, and This is mostly for our members, although anyone who wants to come to our Celebration Sunday lunch next week, it's right after this service. This is the Sunday in the year when we make our financial commitment to the church, and then we all celebrate together as one big family of saints at a wonderful luncheon. So if you have not yet filled out a reservation card saying yes or no, we need to hear either way, please hold up your hand. The ushers have cards. They are coming to you with cards. So if you did not fill out a card last week, please get a card now. If everybody fills out a card, the vestry members won't have to call you at home or email you or text you or Facebook Messenger you or find you. So please fill out a card. And while you're getting the cards, other important announcements are, if you'd like to work on our racial equity task force, we're meeting Tuesday night from 6 to 9 p.m. with a facilitator to begin to do visioning about how our community can be truly anti-racist and radically welcoming to all people. So if you'd like to participate in that work, please speak to me afterwards. Also, in just 3 short weeks, we're going to make Advent wreaths and do Thanksgiving baskets. On the Sunday before Thanksgiving, we will be doing our usual outreach ministry of putting together Thanksgiving baskets for needy families in our community. At the same time, we'll also be making Advent wreaths. If you want to participate in either of those two things, information about both is in the leaflet here. And finally, Annette Molesky is going to be ordained a deacon on December 14th at 11 o'clock. We will be organizing a bus or carpools or something to get us down to the cathedral in Detroit for this great day. So watch for more information about that. And now I would like to have our new members come forward. So if you are joining All Saints today, come on down. We want to give you a gift and welcome you with a prayer. Here we go. We have Pollys, we have Van Wykes, we have Trippies, we have Whites, we have Grooms. Okay, we have Melanie. Okay, I just want to take a minute and have you just introduce yourself so the congregation knows your name and say hi.
Hello, everyone. My name is Melanie.
Hi, Melanie.
Hi, I'm Matt Polly.
I'm Mindy.
I'm Nadia.
I'm Amelia.
I'm Annie.
I'm Kate.
Patty Kroom.
Chris Van Wyck.
Laura Van Wyck.
Simon Van Wyck.
Obzosh Van Wyck.
Hi, I'm Kara Trippy.
I'm Angie Trippy.
Hi, welcome to everyone. And we have a few more. We have a few more families who could not be here today, but it's a wonderful thing to continue to grow the body of Christ in this place. So if you could take out your scripture leaflet, on the last panel it says, a celebration to welcome new members. And there's a prayer for us to pray for them today. With open hearts and warm spirits, we welcome each of you today into our All Saints family. We greet the Christ within you. We greet you as the presence of Christ in our midst. Come in out of the dark into the light of Christ's presence among us here who gather in his name. Come in out of the cold into the warmth of Christ's embrace. Come saint and sinner, come seeker and sought. Come with your questions, your burdens, your gifts, and gratitude. Come with all that you are and all that you are not. Come with all that you hope to be. All are welcome to come into the light of Christ and to be the light of Christ in the world. No matter who you are or from whence you have come, no matter how long or how far you have journeyed, welcome, 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 you are welcome. And together let us pray for our new members. Lord Jesus, you welcomed all who came to you and taught us that in welcoming even the least of our sisters and brothers, it is you we welcome into our hearts. Bless now those gathered here in your name, that we may look upon your countenance in the faces both familiar and new, and make us to know, Lord, that in your body there can be no strangers among us, only friends whom we have not yet met. Amen. Join me in welcoming these new saints.
You are welcome into our fellowship of all saints. Come and be fed, seated with health, serve each person as Christ. Come and be blessed.
Amen. And we have a gift. We have a gift for each new family. We also have Bibles for the kids. Big Bibles, real Bibles. Thank you. Please be seated. And now I'd like to welcome Ann Porter Day, who is going to give us a stewardship minute.
I am so grateful for All Saints Episcopal Church. Since coming to All Saints in 1976, this community of faith has continually encouraged and challenged me to grow in my relationship to God. And there's no greater example of this than the journey I've experienced over the last couple of years as chair of stewardship. Over many years, I had developed several practices for myself about stewardship. For example, my contribution to the church was the first thing that I paid every month. And I worked toward tithing and eventually made the tithe. And I made regular contributions to help those in need and to do good in the world. However, as I began my work in stewardship, I quickly learned that there was much more for me to understand. When I agreed to become the chairperson, Pastor Kit sent me home with a stack of books on stewardship. She asked me to see if I might find any new insights on stewardship to enhance our current practices. These readings did open my understanding in new ways. And then, when a group of us came together to create a vision statement for stewardship, we all learned that in Scripture, Jesus talks more about money and possessions and how we handle them than any other topic except the kingdom of God. I'm sure it will not surprise you to know that when my attention, focus, and prayers were on the discernment of the spiritual practice of stewardship, God was quick to provide me with lesson after lesson about stewardship in my life. So let me share with you just one of the many things that happened during that time. I received word that my income for the coming year was going to be cut by one-third. Now, I had just made my pledge to the church for the coming year, so I decided quickly that I would keep the pledge and the commitment I'd made to the organ renovation. But when I got to the commitment I'd made to the Davies project, I thought, maybe this is the one I should drop to make my budget a bit more comfortable in the coming year. And then I thought, no, I am learning and seeing that all that I have belongs to God, and He has entrusted this bounty to me for the good of others. I'm just going to have to make some more adjustments to my budget and keep this commitment. So off went the check to the Davies Project. The next week, I received a letter from the hospice where my husband Chris had spent his last days 4 years prior. They said they had miscalculated his bill and enclosed a check to reimburse me for the overpayment. It was, almost to the penny, 150% of the amount I had sent the week before to the Davies Project. I did not see this as a coincidence, and I said a prayer of thanksgiving to God. What I did see was real-life evidence that God created everything and continues to own everything. All that we have belongs to God, not us. We are simply stewards of what God has entrusted to us. And the bounty of God flows in the world when we as stewards use what has been placed in our hands for the good of others and we can trust God for what we need. And I saw something else. We can't outgive God. Amen.
Thank you, Anne. And now walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself as an offering and a sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
Eucharist is offered today in loving memory of the All Saints members who died from All Saints in the past year. Rosemary, Dorothy, Anne, Howard, Sonia, and all those named in the Book of Remembrance. We continue with the great thanksgiving in your service leaflet. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. From the multitude of your saints, you have surrounded us with a great cloud of witnesses, that we might rejoice in their fellowship and run with endurance the race that is set before us, and together with them receive the crown of glory that never fades away. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Gracious Creator, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O God, in the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
Thank you.
Please stand as you are able as we send forth our Eucharistic visitors. Pam, in the name of this congregation, I send you forth to Dixie Lee bearing these holy gifts, that those to whom you go may share with us in the communion of Christ's body and blood. We who are many are one body, because we all share one bread and one cup. And the post-communion prayer is on the last panel of your leaflet. Together, let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God,
we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, O God, send us out to do the work that you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To Christ, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, the honor and glory, now and forever. Amen.
Life is short, and we do not have too much time to gladden the hearts of those who travel the way with us. So be swift to love, and make haste to be kind. And may the blessing of the one who made us and who loves us and walks the way with us, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be upon you and those you love dearly this day and always. Amen.